Okay, Ryan's going to talk a little bit about nutrition and where the best placement for your water bottles and to keep as much aerodynamics as you can.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's something that during the ride, you need to have access to your nutrition without moving around much. When you're in your aero bars, it's not comfortable or safe to be fidgeting all over the place and digging things out and those sorts of things. So there are a couple of ideas that the manufacturers have that are very convenient, but that at the same time very aero. And the idea of the convenience is it's critical, again, to your success in the whole event, to stay hydrated and with nutrition in you on a regular basis throughout the day. If it's too much work or it's uncomfortable or unsafe for you to go and reach for a water bottle, you're simply not going to do it. You have to do it. It's critical. So with the aero bars we were talking about earlier, when it's mounted onto the bar, there's actually a bottle option that drops right in between the bars, and it actually hangs right in this area here. There's a straw that sticks up right in your face. As you're riding your bike, whether you're in the drops or on the upper bars, it's very easy to lean forward and just grab a quick drink, whether it's a sports drink or water, whatever you have in there. Certainly easy for you to get at. This is a Profile Designs design as well, called the Aqua Rock. We're going to mount this onto the seat post in behind the seat. There's going to be two bottles here. Some people will run with both bottles and an aero bar bottle. A lot of people will run two bottles, maybe one with sports drink and one with just water. Again, easy access, aerodynamic. A lot of people will carry nutrition in their jersey pockets and things like that, but maybe on your training rides that works, but you're probably not getting out of the water with a jersey on. So unless you're going to put one in a transition, we sell, and everyone, you know, it uses what's called a bento box, and it's a small bag that fits right here behind the stem on top of the top tube, and it allows you to have a few gels, some energy chews, whatever it is that you need to eat or drink during your day to get across the finish line. You're going to have that sitting right here in front of you, super easy access. Again, safe, comfortable, very easy for you to get at, because it's critical that you stay hydrated and you fill yourself with nutrition on a regular basis during the ride, because again, when you get off, you got to run.
So do you still advise people to have water bottles on the tube here?
You certainly can. It's something that we...
in the old days, we had one here, that's how we did it.
Yeah, I mean, you can run them, lots of people will run one here. The one thing with that is if you are going to have the clip-on aero bars, it's not very safe or comfortable to be looking down and reaching down underneath you.
Right.
If you can sit still like this and throw your hand in behind you, pull that bottle out and drink it, or better yet, you're sitting with your hands in front of you and you have the bottle right between your arms, all of a sudden things are convenient. And like I say, if it's not convenient and you don't feel comfortable doing it, you're simply not going to do it, and that's not an option. You have to be able to access your nutrition and your hydration as you go.
Right. So when you put those twin bottles here, is there a small toolkit that will fit underneath there?
It does become pretty tight in there.
Yeah.
Generally speaking, if you were going to have that, what happens a lot of times is what's sold now is the bottle cages here inside the frame.
Right.
You can put a toolkit and a spare tube and a multi-tool in a bottle kit that fits right into a bottle cage here. You're going to use this a lot less often than you're going to use this.
So if you had two spare tubulars, where would you put them?
Tubulars are tough. They're tough to pack.
They take up a lot of room.
They fold up relatively small, but they're still a full-size tire. Basically, it's a full-size tire and tube. So you'll see people with them stuffed into a water bottle, stuffed onto their racks. See people with them taped to the seat tubes. You know, because that's the thing too, is if you put it against your seat tube and then you put the aqua rack above it, yeah, it's not easy to get at, but you're hoping that you don't have a flat, and hopefully you won't have to. But you need to have something just in case.
It's a little bit off topic, but are people choosing more tubular tires or clinchers?
Clinchers. Clinchers.
Yeah. So now you're dealing with changing a tube instead of the bolt.
The biggest thing with clinchers is it makes high-performance riding and rubber accessible to everyone. Everybody can change a tire. Everybody can replace a tube or patch a tube. And the performance attributes of clinchers have grown and accelerated for so much over the years, where tubulars, they're classic technology, they work really great, they're a beautiful, supple ride, even at a very high pressure, but they're just not accessible to most people, because most people don't have a team car following them with an extra wheel, and most people aren't going to bother to wrestle a tubular off on the road, and using a tube is simply not an option because of the wheel that you have.
And when a tubular blows, you pretty well have lost the tire.
Unless you want to sit there and sew it up like they did in the Tour de France back in the day,
You're
kind of out of luck.
So you can have a $18 or $20 tube as opposed to a
$80
or $100,
you know,
or whatever.
And the biggest difference with tubulars versus clinchers used to be the riding performance of the tubulars really was that much better. With the advantages and the advances that we have in clinchers now, they're so supple. You can get a certain wall distance and a larger casing or smaller casing. You can run them at high pressure. They're fast. They're smooth. They're less expensive. and they're serviceable. And so there's a lot of advantages there, especially for people that are getting started. No question, clinchers are where it's at. If you want to have a set of race day wheels, even our highest end wheels that we sell are still coming clincher or tubular. There are people still running tubulars, but clincher is definitely more more prevalent for sure.
Right. Okay. Well, finally, last thing we want to talk about is what can a person do on their own as far as maintenance mm-hmm. that they can handle? Like, mm-hmm. say they go out for a ride and it's raining, what should they be oiling somewhere, or should they? And when should they come in and talk to you about a maintenance?
Sure. The most important areas of your bike to maintain are places where metal on metal work together. By all means, the drivetrain obviously is the heart, and it's the engine. It's the transmission. If the customer is the engine and the bike is the vehicle, this is the transmission. So, certainly in any areas where you're running metal on metal, chain, derailleur pulleys, chain rings up on the front, when those areas are clean and they're well lubricated, it's more fun to ride a bike that's working well, it's running quietly, it's shifting smoothly. All those things come from a nice, clean drivetrain. We sell lots of specialty tools, but you know what? 5 minutes a week, 5 minutes every five rides with an old toothbrush and some soapy water, your bike will love you so much more. The key with that is to wipe it clean after you're done cleaning it, wipe it dry, and then apply some lubrication. It never hurts to lube your chain, to lube your drivetrain. It's quieter, smoother, and it'll last longer. When you're talking about metal on metal, it's wearing itself anyway. If you add some grit in there, you add some sand, you add some dust in there, now you've just accelerated the wear process, and this is a lot of money, you know? So if you're looking at riding regularly and enough for training and doing a couple of triathlons every year, you're going to be putting a lot of miles on your bike. Take good care of it. It'll last you a lot longer. It'll cost you less over the life of the bike. So that's a critical part, cleaning and lubricating the drivetrain. Depending on the seasons, there's dry lube for the summer seasons that doesn't attract dust very much. There's wet lube for the rainy, maybe the early season and the late season, so that when it gets wet, it doesn't get stripped off. You keep it on there for a little bit longer. So there are different lubes for different situations, but cleaning and lubricating your drivetrain is absolutely fundamental to maintaining your bike.
So when's a good time for people to bring a bike into you and let you do the things that you do?
Generally, there are a few symptoms that we notice most. Shifting, you know, the cleanliness of your shifting. When you got a brand new bike or you've just had a tune-up, you click that shifter, it shifts right now. Click shift, click shift, click shift. If you start to notice that you click the shifter up on the handlebar and the derailleur drags a little bit, it goes, and then it shifts up. Now you know. You don't have enough cable tension in your derailleur. It doesn't take much. It's just a small adjustment. A lot of times people who have had a tune-up will come in 2 weeks later and say, I just had a tune-up and it started happening. Well, it's because we put a new cable and housing in there, and we just need to pull the cable through a little bit, trim it, reset the derailleur, and you'll be good. You'll be as good as gold. So little things like that. But if you've been riding your bike for a year after having a tune-up and you're noticing that your shifting isn't clean as it once was, when you pull your brake lever, it doesn't return crisply. When that snaps right back like that, if it's coming back slower and a little bit draggy, what's happening is you've probably got some moisture and some grit built up in your housing, which is the sheath around the cable. Those are symptoms that it's probably just time for an overall service. Another thing that people can do, for example, one of the things we often see with bikes that have been used for a while without being serviced is the wheel gets a bit of a wobble in it. Maybe somebody ran over a pothole, they went down a curb or up a curb. Tire pressure is something that everyone can do on their own. A good pump will cost you $40, and it's invaluable in the performance of your bike and the durability as well.
What's the best performance tire pressure? Around 100?
It varies to weight. Yeah, it's between 100 and 120. There are different preferences. I like a little bit softer, but I'm a big guy. I like a little bit softer pressure. Run mine at just over 100 or just under 110. Some of the guys that we see, they ride track at 160, so they go down the road and they love their tires at 120. They want to feel every crack and rock and pebble. It varies on weight. It varies on preference. But one of the things that the correct tire pressure does, there's a minimum and a maximum listed on the tires. Whatever tire you choose, make sure you're aware of that and pump them up to the appropriate pressure. If you haven't ridden your bike for 3 weeks or 2 weeks, they do lose pressure over time. So make sure before you take it out of the garage and go ride it off the curb and bend your wheel that you put the correct amount of air pressure in there. One of the things that we find is tires that are inflated to the proper pressure create pressure inside the rim. It actually strengthens the wheel. You don't have wheel truing issues. When you run over a curb, the tire deflects. It doesn't actually transmit energy into the rim and bend it. So there's lots of advantages to the correct tire pressure. But the main ones are, again, the comfort of the ride and speed. You know, you want something that's efficient and fast, but still comfortable. And you can get that from tire pressure as well. And again, something everyone can do.
Okay, so someone is trained all year. They got their big race coming up, Ironman Canada at the end of August. When should they bring the bike in for the very last tune-up? probably not too soon before the race, so they have time to.
And if the race is this weekend, and you bring it to us on Thursday afternoon, the race is on the weekend for everyone. So make sure you plan ahead and book yourself an appointment with any bike shop in your area. But I usually tell people to come in 2 to 3 weeks before, because they're probably not going to do any heavy training in that short window in between, but they'll go out for some light rides. If there's any cable stretch to be had, we want to make sure that that stuff is broken in, that those small adjustments are made before they go out to their final race. The recommending of replacing a brand new drivetrain and all cables and housing the day before a big race. Maybe not such a great idea. We want to make sure that if we have time between the final major service and the actual event to work through any kinks, any setup issues with the new derailleur maybe that we've put on and set up the same as the old one. Well, maybe the new one doesn't flex as much as the old one did, so the limit screws have to be set up a little differently. There's going to be a little bit of cable stretch. Okay, let's get that worked out. Get that cable pulled and trimmed to make sure that when you get out to that event, you pull that bike off the rack and head out on your ride. It's optimum from start to finish.
Right. Great. Okay. Well, that's it for this segment. And this is Ray from ironstruck.com, the new improved website. And we're at thebikeshop.com in Calgary. And be sure to visit them. And thanks very much, Ryan.
Thanks very much, Ray.
You know a lot about bikes.
Appreciate your time. If there's any questions out there, info@thebikeshop.com. Visit our website. There's lots of information about fitting and purchasing a new bike. If you want to refurbish an old bike and get it back out there on the road, we're happy to help you with that as well. Anything we can do to help.